Was that something that was aspirational as you were getting through Duke Law School, that you would like to find yourself in a clerkship and a path which would find you there?
I was clueless in law school. I had a very vague, unformed interest in public service, trying to lead a life of some meaning and service to others. I come from a very intentional Christian perspective of how can I serve. I've come to serve and not to be served. So I didn't particularly take to graduate school. I thought my mechanism was going to be for service, was going to be through teaching college. And after 1 year of a wonderful experience at Brown University, and I got a master's degree, but I said, I don't think that this is the road for me. So anyway, I was a refugee to law school, fell in love with it, did well. And so clueless though I was, I had mentors. We all need mentors in life, right? Mm-hmm. And I certainly was first among those who needed mentors. And so an associate dean at the Duke Law School at that time, Tom Reed, grabbed me by the scruff of the neck, so to speak, sat me down in his office and said, you need to clerk. And I said, well, I'm aware of it, etc. So he guided me, and it was almost a private placement, and to the United States Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit. He had completed his research for a book on desegregation decisions in the Fifth Circuit. So that was the background and context. And I had the most glorious year with Judge David Dyer, appointed by President Kennedy, elevated by President Johnson to the Court of Appeals. And it was so glorious. On my last day with the judge, I said, this has been so wonderful. I didn't ask to serve another year. Knew that wasn't even in the realm of contemplation. But I said, I've now been thinking about applying to the Supreme Court. And he said, I'll call Lewis. Well, Lewis was Justice Lewis Powell.
Of course.
Well, I didn't make the cut with Lewis. but I interviewed with him that very summer. They didn't choose their law clerks when the law clerks were in high school the way they do now. And he seemed to like me, sent me to Washington to meet with his with his current law clerks. And I felt very humbled, rightly so, around those three great minds. What I came to find out is I didn't make the cut, understandably, with Justice Powell, who was a very wise man. But he took enough of a liking to me that he recommended me to Chief Justice Burger.
Wow.
So one thing led to another.
When you meet Chief Justice Burger, what's your impression of this guy? White shocked hair and all that other stuff?
Out of central casting and terribly erroneously and unfairly stereotyped, including in particular by the book The Brethren, which was very unfair to the chief. And I have lots of stories about that little episode. But he was unfailingly kind, gracious, always thoughtful by way of example. When our first son was born, right toward the tail end of my clerkship, he said, let's go see your wife and son. So off we go to George Washington Hospital. Wow. To just pay an unannounced visit, which Alice didn't appreciate. She was honored, but still, it was the first child. Things were different in those benighted days. It was 1977. But that just shows the kind of person he was. I never heard him say a critical word, even of Justice Harry Blackmun. Mm-hmm. And Harry Blackmun would not have been on the court, but for Warren Burger. But people go through their evolution, and Linda Greenhouse wrote a book about Justice Blackmun. But someone who had been a moderate, conservative, traditional Republican appointee became really a son, as it were, spiritually, of the Earl Warren Court. I mean, that was a transformation. It wasn't a natural progression. It was a transformation. And yet, even though Harry Blackmun left his boyhood friend, Warren Burger, behind, so to speak, not a single unkind word about him. He did say one time, I don't understand Harry, but it was a sense of perplexity as opposed to anger. There's a paradox there. I don't understand, Harry. And Harry, of course, eventually became an opponent of the death penalty, which is fine as a moral matter. But in his confirmation hearings, he shouldn't have spoken to it, but he did. He said, I think the death penalty is obviously constitutional because the text, he was a textualist, the text of both the original Constitution and then the amendments to the Bill of Rights contemplate the existence of the death penalty. So it's a political question. Factually wrong.
Okay.
Things that I knew from my own experience, one specific one that comes to mind, the chief's law clerks told Stevens's law clerks that, and I'm paraphrasing obviously, that the chief was so disquieted with or disappointed with Justice Stevens's opinions that he had stopped reading them. I have no idea of where Bob or Scott got that.
Yeah.
They got it somewhere. I don't think they made it up, but I checked with my two law clerks, because I interviewed with, and I told the chief through his assistant, because I was no longer clerking for him when that research was being done, and I smelled a rat, as Patrick Henry did. Considered, well, it's going to be on the three branches of government and so forth. It was a total ruse.
Yeah.
But I had a long interview with Bob Woodward. I never heard back from him. And there was, with my cross-checking with my co-clerks, it sounded preposterous on its face. And I checked with both them. They said, well, first of all, one never agreed to be interviewed. The other, Professor Candace Kovacic at American University, said, this is preposterous. And it was never raised. She talked to Scott Armstrong. Well, going back to Judge Newman's lecture, the number of law clerks was fluctuating, and he described that in his wonderful Jackson lecture. So originally there were no law clerks. Then 1887, a law clerk comes in, Holmes and Brandeis, essentially institutionalized the practice. During my first year, the chief had three law clerks. But the next year, he was moving to four, and he wanted one old hand on deck.
Mm-hmm.
So I either drew the short straw, or as I viewed it, it was a great, great opportunity and blessing. And there's a very specific reason. By that point, I thought I'd done okay as a law clerk, but I did not think I was that helpful to the chief. I got the work done. Mm-hmm. In the second term, I knew the court reasonably well. I mean, as well as you can one humble year. And I was able to help the chief much more. I was a much more helpful law clerk.
In what way?
I'll give one specific example. He would come under criticism within the court for the assignments of opinions, that he would keep the plums for himself and send the prunes to other justices, and people can differ on that. But we had one prune of a case in the October sitting in 76, OT 76, and it was called Chris Kraft versus Banger Punta. And I told the chief, it was a very complex, who cares, but it needs to be decided kind of case. I mean, the parties care and the law needs to be clarified, but it's as far removed from an interesting case for the American people. And I said to the chief, I'm very much like the way this has been briefed. It's superbly briefed on both sides. It's an interesting issue for me. I don't think you're going to have any of your brethren interested in the case. And so if you see fit to assign it to yourself, I'd really like to work with you on it. And he saw the, if I may say so, the wisdom of that, and he assigned that to himself. And I think there was a sense of, oh, because it's complex, it's technical, Securities Act of 34, the chief doesn't care about that, but he assigned it to himself. So that was one example of being helpful, as well as just knowing the court and just being able to say, no, I don't think that's going to fly, to my fellow law clerks.
How did he work? Was he one that would like the clerks to take a swing at the first draft, or did he swing at it?
No, he would look to the clerks to produce a first draft. You would always get pretty detailed, what he loved to call thoughts while shaving, and you would discuss the case But he looked to us to wordsmith, but we were to be his good stewards, his good assistants. We weren't there, well, do the best you can. So we did have lots of guidance.
After conference, did he pull you all in and sort of give you a recap of what happened in the conference with the justices?
We would actually get that from his administrative assistant. So he actually had a senior legal person who's Judge Ken Ripple, and then Judge Mayer were the two. Judge Ripple, now Judge Ripple of the Seventh Circuit, was his legal officer at the time. And so he would sit down. I think they would have a very detailed discussion, and then we would sit down with Ken. But we didn't go through Ken, Judge Ripple, in the brief writing process. There we dealt with the Chief Justice.
You were there the year or so after the U.S. versus Nixon. Did the chief talk to you about that?
Never. And I chose not to raise it with him. It's interesting because I'd been clerking at the time for Judge Dyer at the time of the resignation. And, of course, we were following the Watergate hearings on television. There were televisions in those days.
You and I are not that far removed, right?
But no, never raised the subject with him. And he was not one to talk about the court's work other than what we're working on right now. Mm-hmm. He was a great raconteur, and he loved drawing lessons from the past, especially from law practice and community engagement in St. Paul, Minnesota. Those lived vibrantly in his mind. And he was very Brandeis-like in his advice to clerks, which is, go home. Where are you from? You know, you have roots. So it's almost, if Robert Jackson had been clerking, as it were, for a Brandeis, he would have said, why don't you go home to Jamestown, right? As opposed to don't do as I do. I mean, Brandeis was famously from Louisville, Kentucky, and lives his professional life in Boston and then obviously Washington, D.C.
Is Berger a baseball fan?
Not particularly. He liked sports, but he was so passionate about history and resigned from the chief justiceship to take on the bicentennial. That's how passionate he was. So if you're talking to Chief Justice Berger, he'll be talking about perhaps art. He loved music. He loved travel. So it was as if he were a bit more born to the silver spoon, but there was no silver spoon in his house.
Right.
It was a hard scrabble, humble house, and he did not go to Princeton, which he had the opportunity to do, so he could stay close to home and have a paper route here and so forth to help the family coffers.
Well,
no, he resigned in November of 75.
Okay.
And I was in court dutifully taking notes when he was wheeled off the bench for the last time. It was shortly before noon, and a corporate law tax, which I love that stuff, Foster Lumber versus the United States, corporate tax issue, and I was really into the argument. And I heard, sitting where the clerks sit, way over on the side, Chief, and I looked up. So, I mean, it was, as it were, a stage whisper, and it was Justice Douglas, who was sitting in a wheelchair, and he was looked so uncomfortable. I'm sure he was in terrible pain. And sure enough, it was that very afternoon that the news came that he had submitted, ironically, his letter of retirement to Gerald Ford, who, of course, is minority leader of the House of Representatives, had led the wildly unsuccessful effort to impeach Justice Douglas. The scuttlebutt around the courthouse, and the scuttlebutt may have been wrong, but the grapevine had it that Justice Douglas was hearing, not necessarily from the Chief Justice, but hearing that this was his illness was causing postponements of conference and so forth. And I have this vivid recollection that of scuttlebutt, such as it's worth, that Justice White in particular had lost his patience. and he thought that it was time for WOD, William O. Douglas, to step down, that it was interfering with the orderly work of the court. Well, we love Justice White, but we also knew that he did not suffer fools gladly, and that included the bench, when he was sitting on the bench. And we would see that he just lost his patience with counsel when, and he had this wonderful voice. It was a very rich baritone voice, and he'd be leaning like this and engage in colloquy with counsel, and then to show his utter contempt would simply wheel around. He wouldn't leave, but he would turn around and face the curtains. And I said, I don't think that counsel is doing particularly well. We love Justice White. Obviously, he was so renowned in those days for all that he had accomplished. NFL Rookie of the Year, for Pete's sake. A Rhodes Scholar growing up on a potato farm in Colorado, and just the great student athlete that he was. So, but we're also a little afraid of him. He was famous for being very aggressive on the basketball court, the highest court in the land, and finally gave it up after apparently he took out, this is not when I was there, he apparently took out some hapless law clerk that got in his way as he was driving to the basket. So he had sort of a LeBron James build, yeah. Right? But he was so interested in just everything. But he loved sports.
Yeah.
I remember talking to him about baseball. He loved all sports. No, he was lovable. He was I mean no disrespect. I mean this only with affection. He was a big teddy bear. And so story time in his chambers in the early afternoon was a very popular opportunity. You just go in. And he would regale visiting law clerks. And you just sit around or stand around. He'd be sitting in his chair, and he'd regale with just some story from the past, not about the court, and about the court's work. And he had a lightheartedness that was strange in light of the horrors that he had lived through, the horrors that he had experienced in apartheid America, right, with desegregation and all that. But he just had such a joy of life, a joie de vivre, that was disarming, immensely charming.
Did you guys gravitate towards him because of that? Did you kind of find your way in a social setting where you might be?
No, because I didn't personally find myself in those social settings other than the aforementioned story time, which is, when I look back on it, very interesting. It was a story hour. But I think in those days, when we were talking about the 1970s, there was just this real sense of awe and almost of mystery,
right,
about the court and its work. And we also knew this had nothing to do with different factions on the court, that you were really to deeply respect the court's confidences. Justice Brennan had his famous 5-minute rule. If you're even seen talking to a reporter, you have 5 minutes to pack up. Now, he was a great friend of the First Amendment,
yeah,
and freedom of the press, but he also knew that we had to be very respectful, and I think everyone was. I don't recall the mention earlier in this interview of the Brethren represented such a sea change in attitude that suddenly inside the court stories, right or wrong, were being told.
Yeah.
But I was there, everyone imagines a golden era of genuine respect and bordering on reverence for the court.
You talked about Justice Brennan. How did he interface with the clerks and really with the court? I mean, known pretty much as kind of a liberal tilt, but was that really felt?
Yes, I mean, Justice Brennan was an unapologetic liberal with such charm. And I saw the wooing of Harry Blackmun when the story is told, and Linda may pick up this in her book on Justice Blackmun, but I saw it firsthand. Justice Brennan was so delightful, so charming, and he could put on the charm. And I think he was a great charmer to Justice Blackmun. I did not have that much interaction with Justice Brennan, but he was always just unfailingly courteous and the like. But the justice who actually knew the law clerks from the other chambers was Justice Lewis Powell. Mm-hmm. He just took a genuine interest in all of the clerks, what they hoped to do, their hopes and dreams and aspirations. And of course, he thought the right thing to do was go to a great law firm, because of course he'd been a senior partner at a large law firm, and which is how my judge knew him from litigation days. They had actually tried a case together. And in terms of the most accessible by far was Justice Rehnquist. Just call me Bill, we wouldn't. But he was very informal.
Right. Of course, was he the new kid on the block at that point?
Yes. Yeah, he was the junior member of the court in 71, and I was there in 75. But, then Justice Stevens came on fairly soon thereafter to succeed Justice Douglas.
Have you been brought in at all at various points during a conversation where a president is contemplating a naming of a Supreme Court justice, and they sought your opinion?
Not directly, but indirectly. I served as chief of staff to the Attorney General in the first Reagan term. And so I was very privy, one person removed, namely the Attorney General, and the Attorney General's conversations with Ronald Reagan. Potter Stewart came to Bill Smith, Attorney General William French Smith, and said he intended to resign and wanted to go see the president and to tell the president that personally. The attempted assassination intervened, so that meeting between Potter Stewart and the president was postponed. It finally did happen in the residence during President Reagan's continued recovery and recuperation. In the meantime, once Bill Smith, the Attorney General, knew that, he didn't tell me who was stepping down. I was piecing and putting dots together because I was his chief of staff, and he made it very clear, one of your key projects right now is to identify the full range of potentially qualified candidates, and not alone, but with his immediate staff, the Attorney General's immediate staff, with our Office of Legal Policy, collaboratively with the White House counsel. But Bill wanted it in the Justice Department, and it was his responsibility to deal with Fred Fielding, who was counsel to the president. Anyway, so we began that process, and early on in that process, it was very clear that the president's preference was to appoint a qualified woman. Mm-hmm. And so we kind of had a back and forth because in those days so long ago, there were not as many experienced women in bench and bar. There just was not that wide a range of folks. There were qualified women, including Sandra Day O'Connor, but she was a bit of an unusual, let me just use the term dark horse, because she was only on an intermediate, state intermediate court of appeals. And so the most logical candidate was Judge Cornelia Kennedy of the Sixth Circuit sitting in Detroit, a very able judge, and she was indeed a finalist for that Potter Stewart seat. Mm-hmm. So I was very privy to the entire process. I was not in the Oval Office or in the residence to talk to the president about it. It was, I would say, the totality of the circumstances. Her experience, albeit limited, and none in the federal judicial, the federal judiciary at all, was to us a factor counseling restraint. Really, do you want to go that in that direction? But she had these personal qualities as well, just so impressive, one on one, that she clearly was making the finals, and then the very wise people in the White House, the future Secretary of State James Baker, future Attorney General Edward Meese, then National Security Advisor Judge Clark, as we called William Clark, Bill Clark in those days. He'd been a judge on the California Supreme Court. When they interacted with Justice O'Connor, and before that, when Attorney General Smith interacted with her, it was, she's the one. She sort of had, as it were, to borrow from Tom Wolfe, the right stuff.
Yeah.
Very impressive. And she was very impressive, not just the way she carried herself, but she was very learned in the law. She had made quite, over her career, quite a study of Supreme Court jurisprudence in a wide array. So the very fact that she came out of a state intermediate appellate court, ironically, I think, redounded to her benefit in that President Reagan was the architect of the Sagebrush Rebellion. So you don't want to a federal judge who's accustomed to running the country, so to speak. Let's get a state judge in here who will be very sensitive to federalism principles.
Did you ever get a sense that through the selection process there is any interfacing with the current court justices as to thoughts?
I think not. I don't know, but I think not in terms of protocol. I have reason to believe that Chief Justice Berger put in a good word about Sandra Day O'Connor, interestingly enough, to the Attorney General. And I think that was a whispering in the ear sort of thing, just a mentioning it as... but that's an impression that I had from the Attorney General, under whom I was serving. But I think there's a sense, separation of powers, comity, respect. We don't interfere with that. The one that immediately springs to mind was Buckley versus Valeo, involving the regulations. The first time that we had Congress really stepping in, of course, after Watergate, and saying we need to regulate money in politics, at least in federal elections. And one of the reasons I remember that is that there was a sense of urgency, and rightly so, to get this case decided well before the 76 presidential election. So it was argued in late 75, I may be a bit off on this, but this I will always remember. Several of us law clerks were actually brought into the conference room. Justice Brennan presided and parceled out assignments to the chambers. Now, obviously, he had the authorization of the conference. And the reason that that was done is that the chief viewed himself in part, it was a very complex statute, many facets to it, but he viewed himself as being more in dissent, even though he would be partially concurring, in at least in the judgment, and he did. But he did dissent in some very fundamental parts of the case. So to me, that was so memorable. It probably was, as far as we knew, unprecedented.
Yeah, wow.
That law clerks have been coming, they're sitting with a justice, not their own, and he's saying, you'll do this and you'll do that. But again, Justice Brennan was not operating ultra vires. We knew that the entire conference was supportive of this unusual approach. So that's the case that stands out, both of its importance and the unusual way in which it was handled internally. If memory serves, it was issued in January of 76. So really, as the Iowa caucuses were getting underway, et cetera, New Hampshire primary, we had done our job, we being the court.
I don't think we've talked about this, but here at Chautauqua, and one of the former chairmen of the board of directors of Chautauqua was Bill Clinger.
Yes.
Congressman Clinger.
Yes.
In the House of Representatives, was quite active as the chairman of a committee investigating Travelgate and Filegate matters. Was Clinger's findings or investigation in the Travelgate and Filegate, was that part of your investigations?
Yes.
As well?
Yes, and Chairman Clinger and his staff did a remarkable job, a very thorough culminating in an extraordinarily comprehensive report that's available online these days. And I think they really got to the bottom of it. And the bottom line was no crimes were committed, but the report will speak for itself. But essentially that it was an inelegant way of treating these career employees. There was a serious allegation of wrongdoing, mm-hmm. and Billy Dale, the head of the office, was actually indicted by a federal grand jury in Washington, but he was acquitted in fairly short order. There's no question there was sloppy bookkeeping in the travel office, but whether they should have been the career people, and very quickly the White House saw the political damage. They were very popular people with the press. So the travel office people, was the press dealt with them. I need a ride, right? The president's going to Indianapolis or to Warren, Pennsylvania. I need a ride. Right? Well, you're not going to get on Air Force One. That wasn't Billy Dale's prerogative. So anyway, yes, Congressman Clinger did a magnificent, he and his staff did a magnificent job of getting to the bottom of it. No crimes, but one could easily say abusing the privilege of being in power.
Yeah. Has your paths crossed with him here?
No, I haven't seen him in the longest time, but I did see him. In fact, I think the last time I actually saw the chairman was here.
Another Chautauqua connection, and a personal connection, is Professor, now Dean, Ken Gormley.
Yes.
Finished his book, The Death of American Virtue.
Yes.
In My Condominium.
Oh. Well, I think he was fair. I have some fundamental disagreements with him in terms of his conclusions. Mm-hmm. But the basic conclusion, which was very gratifying to me, was that he concluded, based upon his remarkable research, extensive research, that our investigation was conducted honorably. You know, in our profession, the legal profession, integrity is so vital. And so there were so many calls for investigations into the investigator and so forth, so many allegations, so many complaints being issued. So to get a clean bill of health from Ken Gormley is something. Thank you, Dr. Gormley. I'm very, very grateful for that. Now, I do disagree with some of his conclusions in terms of the conduct of the mm-hmm. investigation. And I don't think he took adequately into account, and here I'll be pretty critical, of the obstacles that the Clinton administration was putting in our way, including the invocation of non-existent privileges. To me, the beyond the pale was the invocation of the protective function privilege to prevent Secret Service officers from testifying. It got zero votes along the way, all the way up to the Supreme Court of the United States, zero. And that's nonetheless the kind of thing that we were faced with all the way, as well as the relentless attacks on the investigation. The politics of destruction were brought into our investigation to try to destroy each and every one of us. It's you know, politics is, as James Stewart put it, blood sport.
Yeah.
The author.
Do you still feel that?
Yeah, as an example of someone who led a wildly over-aggressive investigation, why did you do this and why did you do that? And the answer is very simple. Everything that we did was authorized by the tools that we had and the recipe book, so to speak, that prosecutors go by. And I was very encouraged when, at a lecture at the University of Michigan, my predecessor was appointed by Attorney General Reno when the statute was not in effect, and so he was appointed by the Attorney General to investigate Whitewater. When asked in a colloquy, what would you have done differently from, and this after is all over, from Starr, and he said, I don't know of anything I would have done differently. Yeah. So put yourself in the position of the prosecutor's office. You're trying to get to the truth, and that's what we would say. We were like the Ojo Friday, just the facts, nothing but the facts. But think about this. Susan McDougall, convicted of federal crimes, a name from long ago, by a Little Rock federal jury, presided over by a district judge appointed by President Carter, who was an African-American Democrat. Okay? So I don't want to hear anything to the effect that she did not get a fair trial. And yet she refused to cooperate,
right,
not with the investigation, but with the grand jury, and was held in contempt by the federal judge and so forth. And when the President of the United States was asked about that, that she says she's not going to answer questions and so forth because, I'm paraphrasing, Starr is just out to get the Clintons. The President of the United States said, there's a lot of evidence for that. So there was a signal, wasn't it?
Sure.
Also, what about the pardon power? Refusing to say, I'm not going to pardon, and of course he did pardon Susan at the end of it. So I think there was a lack of, I'll just put it mildly, a lack of respect for the legal process. What I was saying is, if I am an out-of-control rogue prosecutor, fire me.
Yeah.
Please. I was not eager to take on the job to begin with. And so if there was this sense or a conclusion that I was abusing power, then there are remedies. You fire. The Attorney General just says, I remove you for cause. That, of course, never happened. So it was the worst of all worlds. You were in this free fire zone because you were doing all these bad things, and yet the obvious statutory remedy, remove this bad actor because he's a rogue, was, of course, not invoked.
Robert Mueller been appointed, and of course he's going through the same thing from the
right.
Do you get a visceral reaction when you read that?
Oh, I do. I was very upset by the attacks first on Rod Rosenstein by the Democrats, who's the Deputy Attorney General. And so I was on ABC, George Stephanopoulos, on Mother's Day of all things. And here is a very fine, respected, and rightly so, United States Senator, Mark Warner, who said the Rod Rosenstein memorandum is, quote, laughable. I got so angry about that comment, so then I was squared off in the ABC program with Larry Tribe, who's my friend from the Harvard Law School. And Larry was calling for impeachment, which I thought, gee, that's a little extreme, more than a little extreme. This is Mother's Day. This
yeah.
is long before the stuff that has since come out over the course of these recent months. So in any event, we have to, in this country, respect the rule of law. Period, full stop. And the chief magistrate, as General Washington would say, must venerate the Constitution and the rule of law. And so, yes, I think we in the bar, the bench can't, but the bar needs to speak out when there is an attack on rule of law. Mueller was properly appointed. You may disagree with it, but he was properly and lawfully appointed. He has a mandate. Now, if he's exceeding his mandate, right, there's a remedy, and that is the Deputy Attorney General fires him. There it is.
Right.
You don't have to, he's not enthroned. He doesn't have life tenure, and he is reporting to the Deputy Attorney General in light of the Attorney General's recusal.
You were independent counsel, and the statute sunset.
Yes.
And would you advocate for its reactivation?
No, in fact, during my tenure as as independent counsel, I testified before the Senate Operations Committee, Government Operations Committee, that it should not be reauthorized. And I had a whole variety of reasons for that, including that I just felt that it was bad policy. We appoint someone as independent counsel, and then we throw him into this free fire zone, and there's no one there to really protect him. Mueller now has that. Under the new regime, he's appointed by the Attorney General or the person stepping in for the Attorney General. And I think we've struck the right balance. Those are regulations, by the way, that Janet Reno promulgated. And in her testimony at that same time, in April of 1999, she said that the independent counsel experiment has been an experiment. We should now allow it to lapse. And she said she was very politic about it. She was very diplomatic. But it's not due to any one independent counsel behavior. It's the structure. It's a bad structure. And so it's very interesting because the Republicans came to hate the statute, as you know, during Iran-Contra, but the Democrats rallied to its cause. Then, then during my investigation, the Democrats hated it, and the Republicans still hated it, although they had their own views about the Whitewater investigation. So by virtue of the both sides of the aisle having their grievances about the two big investigations, Judge Walsh's Iran-Contra and my own experience in Whitewater Lewinsky, it was allowed to expire. And I think the only senator who was really pushing pretty hard for its reauthorization was my friend, the late Arlen Specter. And I love District Attorney and then Senator Specter. And we talked about it. We talked about it privately. But I said, I just think, with all due respect, Senator, that it's the wrong way to go. Let's allow the Attorney General to make the decision to appoint what we now call a special counsel. One of my mentors was the judge for whom I clerked, David Dyer, who just was, to me, the perfect judge. He was so pure in his going about it. The Lady Justice was blind with him. It was a very eager passion for getting the right answer, that there, or at least there's a better answer in resolving this case. So I would say David, Judge Dyer, and then in his own way, even though we're not quite as intimate, even though I had 2 years with him, Chief Justice Berger. And then I read very voraciously as a law clerk, and especially when I was clerking with Judge Dyer and I had a little bit more time than I did at the Supreme Court, which is very, very arduous and challenging. I read a wonderful book by very much alive Judge Henry Friendly of the Second Circuit called Benchmarks. And I was so taken by that. And I fell in love with judicial history, loved reading about Holmes and Brandeis and Cardozo. I loved the founding and the great Chief Justice, John Marshall, the boneheaded mistakes that the Supreme Court would make horribly, right, in Dred Scott, that helped bring on the war, Plessy versus Ferguson. So also just lessons in humility to be, and it's one of the great things about Justice Jackson, that he remained as brilliant as he was, as eloquent as he was, and his mastery of the English language seems to be unparalleled, as Judge Newman paid appropriate tribute to him. He remained humble. Let's not be so sure that we have the right answer. And that's very Holmesian as well.
Yeah. What was the phrase? We're not final because we're infallible. We're infallible because we're final. I mean, that's just
Brown versus Allen. Yeah. That's a Jacksonian stroke of wordsmithing genius. It was a fighting words kind of case, and using really incendiary language. I forget the specific factual context of it, but it raised again this enduring issue of what are the limits on free speech when there is clear social harm flowing from these very nasty words, vile words, attacks, and so forth. Jackson's position almost always was grounded in common sense rather than some overarching ideology, save to the extent of the fundamental principles. There's no star in our constitutional constellation that the government does. So he had the basics down of what the American experience and our constitutional exceptionalism is really all about, including freedom as the baseline. But the Constitution is not a suicide pact. So he would be able masterfully to come to an answer that has, whether it was the majority opinion or not, would withstand the test of time. It remains the Kennedy Court, the remarkable success of Justice Kennedy in positioning himself, and I don't mean to make that sound political, but by virtue of his good judgment to find himself as the kingpin. He calls it. He was in dissent all of two times in the entire term, and he authored no dissenting opinions. But it was also the Gorsuch court, in that even though he's the junior justice, every new justice, and I heard Justice White say this, every new justice changes the dynamic of the court. And what we have in Justice Gorsuch is someone who is very much openly, as he said in his confirmation hearings, a disciple of Justice Kennedy. So the irony is, Justice Gorsuch, the first law clerk in American history to serve alongside the justice for whom he clerked, is as far removed from Justice Kennedy jurisprudentially as was Justice Scalia. And that's fascinating.
Yeah. Are regrets, as you sit here today?
Well, I wish I had not been called upon to become the independent counsel in the Whitewater matter. But I've never turned down a call to or an opportunity to serve the country. And so that's the one prune. I had so many plums handed to me that I did not deserve. And I really mean that. So I've been very blessed to serve in positions that I was at best underqualified for. So it was about time I got a prune. And the prune was investigating a very charismatic president, first in his class, and who was a real fighter, as he told Dick Morris when he had the overnight poll done. Will the American people forgive adultery? Yes. Will they forgive perjury? No. Mm-hmm. And the president's, according to Dick Morris, well, we just have to win then. And so then it was a very difficult time for the whole country.
Kenneth Starr, First Among Equals, 2002. Is there going to be a supplement to this?
I've been thinking about, in my newfound freedom, doing that. There are a number of books underway, however, about the Roberts Court, and some from very, very fine authors. So I'm sort of biding my time. I'm back into watching the court much more closely. I was able to do that when I was dean of the law school at Pepperdine, but since 2010, and this is 2017, I haven't been able to watch the court that closely. I've not ignored the court, but this will be a time of reading and reflection. So this was a book about the Rehnquist court, but gee, it's been the Roberts court for over a decade. So I'm very open to that.
When somebody says, I want to watch the court, what's that really mean?
Really, before the oral argument, if you're following the court and of course they hear 70 or 80 cases a year, so it's a lot of reading. So to the extent that you can, really be fully prepared for the argument itself, then getting the tapes, better yet, my favorite place for observing the Supreme Court of the United States is in the lawyer's lounge at the Supreme Court. So you're not taken away with the optics, but you're just listening over the marvelous PA system, but you're there at the court, and you can take notes freely. There are limitations on what you can do in the court unless you're a member of the press. Yes, do a deep dive and look at these trend lines, and what are you seeing in terms of the recurring themes? So one of the recurring themes, to come back to your earlier question, is the importance of separation of powers. Just almost at every turn, not at every turn, but at many turns, you're seeing this articulation of separation of powers. And of course, there's no more influential articulation of presidential power in our separation of power system than Robert Jackson, his concurring opinion in Youngstown. Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court. Oh, it's scary, very scary. And I served as a law clerk. I'd been in and around the court, but I'd never argued in the Supreme Court. I'd been a judge, so I was accustomed to courthouses, but this is different. You're on the firing line, so to speak. Well, I chose a case coming out of New York, the city of Yonkers versus the United States. Is very intriguing case about judicial power. And Judge Leonard Sand, in Foley Square had issued an order in a civil rights case, a long-lived civil rights case coming out of Yonkers, that involved both housing discrimination charges and school desegregation charges. So it was a hard case, difficult case, but it really boiled down to, has the judge exceeded his power by doing this, by fashioning or crafting in chambers, so to speak, an ordinance, a remedial ordinance, and directing the City Council of Yonkers to enact. So I'm preparing for that argument, and by happy coincidence, the Australian ambassador to the United States, whom I knew and had interactions with, invites a number of us to lunch, and the luncheon guests included Antonin Scalia, then on the court. And among the guests, in addition to Justice Scalia, was the then former chair of the House Judiciary Committee, but then chair of a different committee, Jack Brooks of Texas. And so we've had a very pleasant lunch, and the ambassador was very gracious, and so we adjourn into this beautiful atrium area for a little dimitas, and I find myself in a small group with Justice Scalia and Chairman Brooks. And so Justice Scalia says, well, General, the first Monday in October is coming up. This is September. He said, what are you going to argue? And I said, well, my first case to argue, Justice Scalia, and by the way, I'd served on the Court of Appeals with him for several years before he was elevated, so we knew one another. And I said, it's the Yonkers civil rights case. And he simply lit up like a light bulb. And he turns to Jack Brooks, the member of Congress, and he says, oh, Mr. Chairman, let me tell you what the Solicitor General is going to be arguing in our court. He is going to be arguing that a federal judge can order a city council to enact an ordinance that the judge drafted in his chambers. What do you think of that? Jack Brooks scowls at me, looks at Justice Scalia, turns back and says, that don't sound right to me. And sure enough, Justice Scalia just does this, and I lost 5-4. That don't sound right to me. Oh, so God. The judge had exceeded his power, but we went down a game. But that was my first argument. Judge Bork, with whom I had served, and when it was announced that I was becoming Solicitor General, he had retired or resigned from the U.S. Court of Appeals after the unpleasantness of his own confirmation hearing in 1987. So I became SG in Solicitor General in 1989. So Bob calls me up and says, let's go to lunch. We go to lunch at the Monocle, his favorite place on Capitol Hill, which was also kind of a hangout of Chief Justice Rehnquist. So we're having lunch, and he said, Ken, I just want to tell you something. I know you're going to be anxious about your first argument, but after three or four arguments, it will be, well, this is where I go to work in the morning. It becomes more natural, but I've argued 36 cases in the Supreme Court, 25 as Solicitor General, but in those 25 cases, I was on edge every single time. Now, I never fainted at the podium. And we all foul up. One of the areas where you're not supposed to foul up is when you move the admission of someone for membership in the Supreme Court bar. So on this particular day, it was a busy day, as I'll explain. I am looking at Chief Justice Rehnquist and said, I move the admission. I've had two people from the Department of Education, the General Counsel, from HHS, Health and Human Services, the General Counsel and the Deputy General Counsel. So I was moving their admission to the Supreme Court bar, just as a courtesy. And so I said, I move, Mr. Chief Justice, may it please the court, I move the admission of, and I go through the magic language, and then I stop. What I didn't realize is I had left out a key sentence, and I am satisfied that they possess the requisite qualifications. And I'm looking at the Chief Justice, and the Chief Justice is looking at me, and there's just this silence. And then he says, and you're satisfied that they've, oh, and I go, exactly, I remember it as if it were yesterday, I go, oh, And at this point, the whole courtroom, especially the press off to the left over here, is just going absolutely crazy with laughter. And I said, and I'm satisfied that each possesses the necessary qualifications. Well, Legal Times, a legal periodical at the time, wrote in a column called Inadmissible, Tony Morrow said, it was clear that Starr had a lot on his mind, because that morning I was arguing the Spotted Owl case in the Supreme Court coming out of the Ninth Circuit. Then I was hastening to hop on a Coast Guard aircraft to take me to Atlanta to argue an emergency appeal of an order halting the Haitian Coast Guard immigration situation because of this mass exodus from Haiti. Then I flew back from Atlanta, went into another moot court, took a late train, the latest train I get to Philadelphia, and argued in the Third Circuit the next morning. I was not thinking about possessing the requisite qualifications. But the point of that overlong story is the Solicitor General, most to bench and bar, is the character who argues cases in the Supreme Court. But the Solicitor General's office has responsibility for litigation around the country, not just deciding what the government should take up to the Supreme Court, but also the conduct of litigation throughout the courts. And I really enjoyed, not that particular day, that was out of control, but I very much enjoyed going around the country and arguing in the courts of appeals as the SG. Justice Marshall was so formidable, but I knew him from his teddy bear environment as a story time, but it was not story time, and he was not a teddy bear. The case was the Oklahoma City school desegregation case, and the issue was, had the district judge, Luther Bohannon, in Oklahoma City, properly released the Oklahoma City school system from federal judicial supervision? It had been under federal judicial court order for over 20 years, almost 30 years. But the judge said, you've done all that you can to desegregate the system, legal desegregation. Now, not surprisingly, as is true in so many cities, there were neighborhoods that were overwhelmingly African American. The schools in those neighborhoods were therefore predominantly African-American, or even overwhelmingly. So the issue that remained is, what is the responsibility for the city, the school system, to continue to, and then what's the responsibility of the federal court, to continue to try to, quote, desegregate the de facto those schools? And we in the United States, the Civil Rights Division, took the position, the state, the community, is not responsible for neighborhood segregation unless you can prove some causal relationship to the law. So we said we believe that the city system has been unified, has been desegregated and dismantled and so forth, but you still had these de facto segregation situations. And so when I'm presenting argument, we did win the case. Oklahoma City was trying to get it had succeeded the district court. The Tenth Circuit had reversed, and then the Supreme Court granted cert, and we came in on the side of the Oklahoma City school system. And so that's when Justice Marshall thundered, General Starr, you're saying that the United States is in favor of segregation. And I said, emphatically not. I mean, so you can imagine how, shall I say, stunning that was. And of course I tried to explain our position. The end of the story, as I recounted the book, is that when we repaired to the wonderful office, the Solicitor General's office, that's provided very kindly and generously by the Supreme Court to the SG, just for use on court days. You don't go up there if court's not in session. But there's a small office, it's just a holding area in effect, but well, there's a desk and so forth. And it's adjacent to the lawyer's lounge, so you can go back and forth to the lawyer's lounge, which is not a bar, it's not a cocktail lounge. So it's just, again, an amenity. So I am back in the SG's office, and after the argument, and in comes the counsel for Oklahoma City, Ronald Day. And he has in tow with him someone who he introduces as the chair of the school board, elected by the people. The duly elected chairperson of the school district, of the school board, is an African-American woman. Hmm. And she says, I'll always remember this, Mr. Starr, thank you for helping us get control over our schools again. She didn't want, as the chair of the school board, to have to go to federal court to change this route or make this educational modification. She wanted control over the schools. And that's one of the things that Judge Bohannon had emphasized in his opinion, saying that we've achieved integration, which is, or desegregation, I should say, because this is a school board that is operating in good faith, mindful of its obligations under the Constitution and the laws of the United States. So that was a memorable argument. Well, Justice Scalia was always the most, or almost the most, aggressive. But the justice who tended to ask the first question, and not atypically, the question that went to the core of the case was Justice Sandra Day O'Connor. Hmm. You knew that she would likely ask something pretty early on, of both sides. She was, I thought, very skilled at probing the position of both sides. I was surprised that neither Justice Brennan nor Justice Marshall was more active in questioning. I expected them to be more active, but they were getting on in years, both soon retired. Justice Brennan, when I was still serving as Solicitor General, and Justice David Souter got that the Brennan seat, so to speak. But Justice White was a fairly active questioner. But one of the most memorable was Chief Justice Rehnquist was asking me at one point, "Counsel, are you suggesting that Oklahoma Publishing Company versus Walling should be overruled?" I had never heard of the case. And so I took the chance. I said, "Emphatically not, Your Honor." And then I tried to return the argument. And happily he didn't. I have to follow up. "And why is that?" Because I would have been duck soup. Yeah. I was a goner. But I'd stumbled into some obscure, well, it was an obscure case, but as you know, Chief Justice Rehnquist had a phenomenal memory and an extraordinary grasp, even for a judge, even for a Supreme Court justice, an extraordinary grasp of the court's case law, its jurisprudence, including in some pretty obscure areas.
Just out of kind of one final curiosity note, did your paths, have they crossed socially with Clinton? Did you
know? No. And several different people in different contexts said, "Would you be willing to have a quiet, private time of reconciliation?" I said, "Anytime, anywhere."
Well, I noticed you've gone pretty public about, you know, reconciliation, recognizing his post-presidency work.
Yes,
kind of Jimmy Carter-ish.
Right. Very much. And President Carter demonstrated that one can live greatly after the presidency, however successful or unsuccessful the presidency may have been. So it's great to see presidents really caring about the country. And I know the foundation has had issues, but nonetheless, a lot of the foundation's work has been very important. I saw it firsthand in Rwanda.
What's the question that you expected, or the question I failed to ask you?
You've covered the waterfront brilliantly and beautifully. The only question is, when can I return to Chautauqua?